You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hey there, hi there, ho there, we're as spacey as can be. Welcome back to Introduction to Planetary Science and Astronomy, Physics 195 at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I am Bruce Betts, the Director of Science and Technology for the Planetary Society. Today, we are going to step outside our solar system we've been going through and talk about exoplanets, planets around other stars. That's going to lead us to talk more about some about technique than we have since probably the second lecture, because the techniques used to find these objects are different. And then at the end of the lecture, we'll start talking about stars. And to do that, we will bounce back into our solar system and talk about our star, the Sun. And then next week, we'll continue on with the Sun, stars, and the like. All right, so remember you can ask questions, and you can check things out online. Let us talk exoplanets. Now, exoplanets is a burgeoning field, but recall, or not, depending on your age, as of 22 years ago or so, we didn't know of any planets around other stars. We figured they were probably there, but we couldn't tell. So the challenge with detecting exoplanets is it's kind of like trying to find a gnat in a spotlight. It's there, but the spotlight is just the brightness of the spotlight's going to dominate it and make it really tough to do. Well, the same thing is true with exoplanets. So you got a planet going around a star. The star is going to be super, super bright, and the planet's not. And so they've had to come up with rather creative techniques, mostly for finding them. Now, as opposed to a couple decades ago when we didn't know of any, as of a couple days ago, there were 3,475 confirmed planets around other stars that we found. There's another 4,500 candidates, ones that have been possibly detected, but they need follow-up. And usually about 80-90% of those end up being confirmed. But as of right now, we're at 3,475. Of those, 581 are multi-planet systems. Or I'm sorry, there are 581 multi-planet systems that have been found. So more than one planet discovered. So truly other solar system equivalents, although as we'll see, they often look quite different than our solar system. So the challenge for people who study things like origin and evolution of the solar system was that for most of history, we had one laboratory, our solar system, that we knew about. And now people are finding all sorts of exotic stuff in other solar systems that we'll talk about. Totally different placement of planets migrating around over time. We'll get there. I'm going to use a lot of diagrams. So one of the real themes, just to give it away and I'll keep saying it over and over, is how diverse these other planetary systems are, how different they are than ours. And so we're going to look at a lot of examples, many of them very quickly, demonstrating how different this collection of almost 3,500 planets is compared to what we live in our solar system. All right, let's go ahead and look at the first image. So this is artist conception, basically stuck a Jupiter-like planet near a star passing in front of it. This leads to the transit method and hot Jupiters. But we'll get back to that in more detail. First, let's go to the next image. And this is a set of diagrams that I'm going to use to, again, mostly to make this point of the diversity of the exoplanet systems we found. These were made by Dr. Darren Ragazine, who's now at the Florida Institute of Technology, did some work with the Planetary Society, visualizing these systems. This is our solar system. So since I'm going to keep popping up these diagrams, I want you to show you what to pay attention to. This is what's going to change in terms of the diagram, is the scale bar. So that's a 30 AU scale bar, which you may recognize. 30 AU is the distance to Neptune, approximately. 30 times the Earth-Sun distance. Notice on this scale, all we're seeing are the larger planets, and the planets we look at in future graphics like this, red will be Jupiter-sized, yellow will be Saturn-sized, blue will be Uranus and Neptune-sized, and if they make it down into Earth range, they'll be greenish. And then the color of the star will vary coded to what type, spectral type of star it is, what color the star is. We will talk about that a lot next week. We will touch on it this week when it is relevant. But stars come in lots of different flavors, and those flavors are represented by different colors, which ties to different temperatures, and correlated to that is different sizes. Okay, another point to make, next image. So realize that almost all except for one of the techniques I'll discuss is only really sensitive to an area. Here they say 300 light years from the sun. It may be out to 1,000, but it's something like that, which sounds like a lot. It is a lot. It's really far. But the Milky Way galaxy that we'll talk about in one of the last couple lectures is 100,000 light years across. So we're looking, every planet we're finding, with the exception of like five, every other one of those 3,500 planets is in this little bubble right here, because the techniques, it's hard enough to find the exoplanets, but the techniques are more sensitive, not surprisingly, to when you are closer to these stars that you're observing. So keep that in mind, and also you can start pondering the profound math of, if we found that many planets and we're still finding them in this little bubble, again, little being a relative term, then think what's throughout the galaxy and what's throughout, I mean, there are 200 billion stars in the galaxy. There are about 100 billion, 200 billion galaxies. It becomes staggering how many planets there are. All right, now let's talk about the what you would think of as the most obvious way to find exoplanets, which in fact is, again, also only found a handful, and that is direct observation. Next image was this is from Hubble Space Telescope. And if the planet's really big and it's the star is comparatively close, still it's going to be light years away, and the planet is really far from this star, then you may be able to observe it directly. So this is Hubble observations. The star Fomalhaut is in here. And in fact, it's where they've put that dot right there. But they've covered this area with a coronagraph, a mask, to block out that bright light to make it even vaguely possible to see little planets. All this crud here is indeed crud. It's to get the contrast you need. There's lots of noise from the electronics, the detectors, that is in your data. But in observing this over time, this little square is blown up to this square. They saw this dot move from 2004 to 2006. And in fact, I've not updated this. They now have observations over later years, and it continues to move, so indeed consistent with a planet. This is a 100 AU scale bar. Remember, Neptune is at 30 AU, Pluto at 40. This is 100 AU, and so it's about 120-ish AU from its parent star, four times farther out than Neptune. So have we taken pictures of other planets? Yes. And this is what they look like, dots, and it's only worked for a handful, 5 to 10 of these, of the 3,500. Next image. So this is that system, Fomalhaut, whatever, that star. And we've got a big, so out in the Jupiter or bigger category planet. This is now a scale bar of 1.2 times 10 to the 2, so 120 AU is roughly the distance to this. Notice its orbit's slightly elliptical. Star is a different color, meaning it's a different spectral type. Next image. This is another image of a beast, I believe a planet, or what's even bigger than a planet, which goes into a brown dwarf category. We'll talk about that more when we talk about stars. But the transition is around 13 Jupiter masses. Remember, Jupiter's really massive. So these are big objects. But again, this is a 55 AU scale bar here, and this is the brightness of the central star. And then one more, next image, GQ Loopy. And indeed, you've got star, but with the European Southern Observatory Very Large Telescope, they were able to observe this large planet out at distance. I guess there's no scale bar on that. All right, so this has been done. We've seen planets, again, nothing more than as dots, although we are in some cases able to do spectroscopy on them, as we'll learn a little more. But because the stars are so far away, the angular distances are so tiny to resolve a star and its planet, and you have to block out the light from the star, usually, we've only found 5-10 of these out of 3,500 planets. And so this is not the best way to find them, but it is the most direct and obvious way to find them. Let's talk about the first really successful method to find lots of planets, and that was the radial velocity method. Let's look at images. So let's look at the next image. And this is Lick Observatory in Northern California. This is one place where these measurements have taken place. The measurements have been done on various telescopes. The key is, next image, the so-called back end of the telescope. And that is the fancy spectrometers and electronics that you put on there. This is Deborah Fisher from Yale University. Planetary Society funded some of this back end stuff. Because you need to do very precise spectroscopy. And we keep talking about spectroscopy, and now we're going to talk about it again, but with a different application. But what we need to understand is, we need to understand the concept of redshift, which I've probably mentioned, but we need to understand it in more detail. And so I was looking for videos to help understand the concept of redshift. I found one with an alien spacecraft and a cow. And I thought, you know, that's what my class needs. So whenever you're ready, we can go ahead and run the video.
Ask an astronomer. What is a redshift?
Astronomers often use the term redshift to describe how far away a distant object is. To understand what a cosmic redshift is, think about sound. Sound travels in a wave. You hear the engine of an airplane because the waves travel through the air to your ear. If the airplane is moving, the sound waves in front of it are compressed, creating a higher frequency sound. The sound waves behind it stretch out, creating a lower frequency sound. As the airplane passes you, you will hear the familiar Doppler shift. Light also travels in waves, and a similar thing happens to these waves. Light waves are able to compress and stretch, thereby changing their frequency or color. Blue light has shorter wavelengths than red light. When an object in space moves towards us, its light waves are compressed into higher frequencies or shorter wavelengths. And hence, we say that the light is blue shifted.
We missed the cow. But anyway, the alien spacecraft comes and picks up the cow. The cow's fine, I'm sure. well, okay, I'm not really sure, but it's cartoon cows, so it's okay. So the concept is when things are coming at you, then the Doppler shift, things are blue shifted, and I'll talk about this in more detail over the next couple minutes. If they're going away from you, the spectrum will be red shifted. So how does this apply to finding exoplanets? Well, clever people came up with the realization that planets are, as they go around the star, let's take an extreme. So remember Pluto, very much not a star. Many people think not a planet, but Pluto's Charon, they go around a central point in their orbit because they're similar in mass. Well, a planet going around the sun, for example, Earth going around the sun, Jupiter going around the sun, that gravity between the two objects, the planet has enough gravity that the star is not just rotating in one place, it's actually orbiting. Now, maybe orbiting a place within the star, but it's orbiting. So we'll refer to that as a wobble. The star is wobbling. Wobble, 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 wobble. Now, let's look at this graphic full screen, which is an exaggerated version of this, but gives you the connection between wobbling stars and redshift and blueshift. So in this case, they've got more than a wobble. They've got an orbit around a point, and you'd have a planet, planet going around. And so its gravity is tugging. These two are synced up in their orbits. When this star is going around in this circle or wobbling, will correlate with the planet, and when its gravity is what it is tugging. So when the star is coming towards the Earth a little bit more, and that could just be in whatever respect to a point within the star or outside the star, when it's coming towards the Earth, then you'll get blue shift. When it's going away from the Earth, you get red shift. When it's crossing in front or behind, you get no shift because this only affects going towards you or away from you. That is the radial direction, radial velocity method. We're detecting the velocity of the star in the radial direction and how it changes. Let's look at the next image and take this to stellar spectrum. So if you've got a spectrum at the top, this is a spectrum with absorption lines and visible wavelengths and different atoms, whether they be hydrogen, helium, sodium, create these absorption lines. As light is leaving the star, the atmosphere of the star has these atoms or molecules in it, and they absorb light and preferentially and create these dark lines if you just project the spectrum. They can also do it in graphic form. So when the star is going away, then all of the lines get shifted to longer wavelengths. When the star is headed towards the observer, towards Earth, well, I should say in a relative sense. Now the star is probably heading away from Earth in general. What we're looking for is the variation, so not the absolute velocity that it's on average heading away. It's when is it wobbling towards us and wobbling away from us. And that will now cause blue shift. So things shifting to shorter wavelengths. Now so when you're in the visible spectrum, this all makes perfect sense because red shift is shifting towards red wavelengths and blue shift is shifting more towards blue wavelengths. But we use this term even in the infrared when if something is red shifted, it's actually way out there moving away from the red part of the spectrum. But in this case, red shift derived from doing it in visible wavelengths and means you're shifting to longer wavelengths, blue shifted to shorter wavelengths. And how do we apply all this? I tell you, this is not as obvious as just staring at a planet. So that's why we're going into this technique description. All right, let's look at the next image. And this is another beast. Now, this technique and the next technique we'll talk about, transit, are both most effective at when planets are really close to their star. This is a 0.031 AU scale bar. So this planet, which is Jupiter-sized or bigger, is only 3% of the distance that the Earth is to the Sun. It is really close to its parent star. When we started looking at planets and finding other planets, the first things that were found, pretty much dominating, were hot Jupiters. They're Jupiter-like. We presume they're gas giants, but somehow they're really, really close to their parent star. We think that people had to develop whole theories and models and computational simulations to explain this, because it wouldn't be stable in the early solar system, as we talked about last week. We don't think they would be able to form there. Well, it turns out we think now they could form out in an outer part of a solar system, and then due to perturbations, gravitational with the other planets, end up migrating inwards towards jumping Jupiters, jumping in towards the parent star. Okay, so that's what the, and why is radial velocity more sensitive to this? Because you've got the planet gravity. Remember our equation last week, gravity falls off as the distance squared. And so, just pretend that's r squared. And so your planets exert much more of a gravitational tug. There's going to be much more wobble when the planet is close to the parent star. Also, gravity is proportional to mass, and so the more massive the planet, the more wobble you're going to get. Okay, next image. What does this actually look like when we start trying to plot, visualize these things? This is an example of radial velocity, where you zero point is where the star is on average, and then you have plus 20 meters per second there, minus 20 meters per second there. Not sure what the convention is, but let's say plus is blue shifted and this is red shifted. Anyway, doesn't matter for these purposes of this, but you see this is data with error bars. That's what those points are, data with error bars. And it forms a nice sine wave kind of thing going on there. And if you look at the same part of the, like where it crosses zero, you can, one wavelength is this, that is the period of the orbit, which in this case is 2.6 days. So it takes 2.6 days to go from here to here. Remember, this is compared to planets in our solar system that are at least tens of days, usually hundreds of days or years. So this is, again, a planet that is very close to its parent star. So you get this data of radial velocity versus time. This is basically time. They've plotted it as phase, so they've defined that just as 0 to 1 when it goes through one orbit. You can derive what the period of the planet is, and you can extract an approximation of mass due to the gravity in the two parts of the system and the period of the orbit, and get an idea of data about the planet. Okay, let's look at the next image, go back to one of these diagrams. And so this is just more example of diversity. This is kind of a Saturn-sized planet. And stars usually have fun, exciting names, named often after the survey that cataloged them. So this is star HD209458. We all know and love it. Okay, maybe we don't. And here again, a little tiny scale bar, 0.0471 AU. So another very, very close-in planet. All right, there are multi-planet systems we've discovered, I mentioned. Next image is a diagram comparing one of the first really fleshed out multi-planet systems. One back on the images, one back. Oh, are we missing one that looks like, that has a black background? There it is. All right, so this is from, you know, looking above the plane of the solar system. This is our solar system down here, and this is the 55 Cancri system up here. Looks kind of vaguely similar. You got some inner planets hanging out in here. You got at least one big giant planet hanging out here. So there are both really different systems and really similar systems that we have found. Next image. Here we've got a 0.22 AU scale bar. So again, everything is inside Mercury. Mercury at its closest point to the sun is about 0.3 AU, and it goes out to like 0.45 AU, something like that. And notice now we see an elliptical planet. Other than Mercury, we really don't see much in the way of particularly elliptical orbits, although Mars is non-trivially elliptical. And planets, and now notice we're getting into greenish colors, indicating more Earth-sized. We're just going to sample some more here. Next image. So this is just, diversity. We got something, this 0.21 AU, and we got stuff really close in. We got elliptical. We got everything from, can't tell if that's Earth or Neptune-sized, and Saturn and Jupiter. Next image. But again, multi-planet systems. And then we got stuff like this. This 0.44 AU scale bar, so kind of out to Mercury's orbit. But you've got this massively elliptical, really, really elliptical, very eccentric orbit of the a Jupiter-sized object. So this creates challenges and fun problems to solve as one models solar systems and tries to figure out how you end up with something like that. Okay, next image, and then I'll talk for a little bit. This is an example. This is now, there are a lot more planets found, and we'll look at an updated version of this. But this, get used to these kind of plots. This is orbital eccentricity. So a perfect circle is down here and semi-major axis. So the Earth is not that far off zero. Here's the Earth and 1 AU by definition. And you see this distribution in both directions. And we'll see that even more with more data. So there's a lot of variability out there. I know I keep repeating it, but it's kind of the point. Okay. I will take a question, and then I will talk a little bit more to tidy up the radial velocity method. From Katrina, is it possible that there is a planet in another system that has life on it that needs different conditions to live than what life on Earth needs? It is certainly possible. In the search for life, kind of the easiest thing we can do is look for conditions that resemble Earth, and that is requiring liquid water, source of energy, and certain atoms. But even any concept that at least most people have come up for life, we think is going to play by similar rules. Water acts as the solvent in life, and so you need something like it. Water happens to be prevalent in the universe. Because there's a lot of hydrogen and a fair amount of oxygen, and is really good at being a solvent. You're going to need certain atoms. Those could be other atoms, and again, you could have a different solvent. We don't know how you would have life without some form of energy, whether it's chemical energy or energy from a sun. So there are certain components that, at least without stretching your mind really far in a science fiction kind of a way, it's hard to imagine that some of these things wouldn't be relevant, because just to have a self-replicating system of life, you would need them. But it's an interesting thing to ponder, and people do ponder it, and there's a whole field of astrobiology of people trying to figure out life on other worlds. And no, reminder, we have not found it, but it may be out there. All right, so radial velocity is using that wobble of the star, so, and it's looking in the direction. So if you're the observer, you're looking at if this is the star, it's coming at you and going away from you, at you, going away from you. And that is the motion that you are using to extract the presence of a planet going around it, or multiple planets. You get more complicated graphs that will see patterns of multiple periods appearing within it. And the great thing, or let's talk about limitations. Limitations of this technique is, one, it's sensitive to the mass and the tugging, the amount of wobble. Two, if I hadn't mentioned it already, this and pretty much the other methods I'm going to discuss are really hard. They have to be really sensitive. We are detecting motions of stars that are light years away. We are seeing spectroscopic evidence of motions on the order of 1 meter per second. That's, meter per second.
tiny.
And in fact, to get down with radial velocity to finding Earth-like planets in Earth-like orbits, you need to get down to tens of centimeters per second. And that's still just getting there and still working on it with radial velocity method to do that. So it's really, really challenging. You do get a mass out of this, but it's unclear depending on what your, well, first of all, here's our plane of another solar system. If the solar system is faced like this, then the star is going to wobble in the plane and we will see no radial velocity. So it's completely insensitive to solar systems that are oriented like this towards Earth, or very insensitive to ones that are near that. Does great when it's nearly edge on, does a lot better than the transit method, which really has to be edge on, as we'll talk about. But there's an uncertainty in the mass based upon not knowing the exact orientation of the planets. But we do extract a mass from it. We do not, what we extract is mass and period of the orbit. We do not extract a size. We can infer that from our experience, but it is insensitive to size, as opposed to the transit method, which detects size, but not mass. Although, you can get there. yeah, it's all pretty good. So ground-based observing has mostly used radial velocity, as well as because you can. Okay, let us take a look at the next image, and then we'll watch a video. So. Here you've got, and so you're looking at exoplanets. They tend to get classified as like Earth-sized or Jupiter-sized. And if it's Earth-sized, you figure odds are it's rocky, based upon our understanding the physics behind things, and obviously our own example in our solar system. If it's Jupiter-sized, figure it's probably mostly gas. If you're Neptune or Uranus-sized, then it's a little less clear. Could be gaseous. Could be Neptune-sized, and depending on what other observations we may be able to get, we may be able to make some inference about that. So we're going to watch the next video, which on alien atmospheres, which we'll talk some. I think it'll talk about radial velocity and transit method, but also talk about efforts which are ongoing and advancing rapidly in trying to actually study the atmospheres of these other planets. Again, we can't see them, can't resolve them at least, but using spectroscopy, we can try to start figuring out characteristics of those atmospheres. So let's go ahead and watch that.
Since the early 1990s, astronomers have known that extrasolar planets, or exoplanets, orbit stars light years beyond our own solar system. Because most exoplanets are too far away to be directly imaged, characteristics such as size, composition, and atmospheric makeup must be determined through a variety of indirect methods. For instance, when an exoplanet passes in front of its star, or transits, it blocks a fraction of the star's light and causes a dip in brightness. Large planets block more light, so the size of the dip can be used to determine the size of the planet. By observing an exoplanet's gravitational pull on its star, astronomers can also determine the planet's mass, and thus calculate its density, to see if it is composed of rock, like Earth, or gas, like Saturn. But to fully understand an exoplanet, astronomers must study its atmosphere, and the information that they need is encoded during a transit. As the planet crosses its star, its atmosphere absorbs certain wavelengths of light, or colors, while allowing other wavelengths to pass through. Because each molecule absorbs distinct wavelengths, astronomers spread the star's light into its spectrum of colors to see which wavelengths have been absorbed. The dark absorption bands act as molecular fingerprints, revealing the atmosphere's chemical makeup. Knowing the depth and density of the atmosphere is also important. To figure this out, astronomers observe the transit at many different wavelengths. At wavelengths where more absorption occurs, the planet will appear larger, with a change in size indicating how deeply the atmosphere extends, and its density at different altitudes. Measuring the depth of absorption at each wavelength gives astronomers the planet's transit depth curve, which allows them to model the composition, height, and density of the atmosphere, providing a detailed picture of the planet. Recent studies suggest that exoplanets and their atmospheres come in a wide variety. At one extreme are hot Jupiters like WASP-19b, a boiling gas giant that orbits its star far closer than Mercury orbits our Sun. Visitors who could survive the heat might complain about the air quality. Planet WASP-19b's jagged transit depth curve suggests a deep atmosphere of poisonous hydrocarbons, with methane and hydrogen cyanide far more abundant than water. By contrast, planet GLISO-1214b is a comparatively inviting water world. Its nearly flat transit depth curve hints at a shallow atmosphere of pure steam enveloping an ocean thousands of kilometers deep, with an interior of hot ice, water solidified by extreme pressure rather than cold. As detection methods improve, astronomers will search the atmospheres of Earth-sized planets for signs of life such as water vapor, oxygen, and methane, taking us one step closer to finding a world like our own, all thanks to some flickering starlight.
So I'm still amazed by what they can do, because you just have to get really clever to study that gnat around the spotlight, and both the finding and then the ability to actually use spectroscopy of light coming through the atmosphere, and you have all these techniques, by the way. You have a lot of other competing stuff that you have to take out. You've got the basic velocity of the star. You have the stars, particularly in the transit technique we'll discuss next, but stars, they do stuff. As we'll talk about later this lecture and next lecture, stars are not just passively sitting there. They're carrying out nuclear fusion. They got crazy magnetic field stuff going on. And so some of them are variable. They naturally vary in brightness due to other physics reasons having to do with the star and what it's doing. My point here, I guess, is just these are really crazed measurements. They're really challenging and hard. And so we see the end result of, oh, look, they found a planet. But it's actually very careful, hard work. And that also leads to mistakes. And so Alpha Centauri, one of the main stars in Alpha Centauri, was announced to have a planet around it. And the evidence didn't hold up with more observation. Now, Proxima Centauri, the small red dwarf star, does appear to have a planet around it. But anyway, it's a complicated field. Let's talk transit method. So as we'll see in a graph in a little while, the two main ways we have found other planets are radial velocity, which we just talked about, and transit method. Transit method is basically requires you to have a solar system that is nearly edge-on to Earth, or at least very close to it, because you are relying on, look, my big giant planet passing in front of my fist star. It has to actually pass in front of it. When it does, it dims the light, but just the tiniest little bit. And then the light, as you know, the starlight, you're seeing the starlight, dims slightly, comes back. We'll look at better versions than bottle caps and fists. So you're looking for slight dimming of stars. And that's what you do. So let's look at the next image, see what that looks like in artist concept and graphic, which is, here's our little planet, and here it is passing in front of the star, transiting in front of the star. And then as it goes in front, you'll see the intensity, the brightness of the star will dip. It'll stay dipped until it comes back up, and then it does that. Let's go ahead and watch this video with my sound up, basically just doing that in a graphical kind of way. So the key to this is staring at stars over and over and over and over and over again. And so here you have the planet passing in front. They've added some squiggles to make the data more realistic. Data never looks as perfect as it did in the last graphic, because you do have all sorts of sources of noise in your data. And so that's a transit. And the transit is anytime one body passes in front of another as seen from a third body. Let's look at this graphic full screen. So this shows you get different dips depending on different characteristics of things. The top three are demonstrating the different size stars. So yes, stars come in different flavors. And so if you got a big star on the top three, you have different size stars, same size planet at the same distance from the star. And so you're gonna see percentage wise a smaller dip in light if you got a bigger star. And you're gonna see a bigger dip if you got a smaller star. On the bottom, we have the same size star, planet at the same distance, but now we vary the size of the planet. And so the planet, small planets block out less light, big planets block out more light, again for the same distance, because we have the size of the star, the size of the planet, and the distance of the planet from the star are all variables in how much dipping you get. And stars have natural variability in their brightness, and so it is important to sort those things out from these appearances. Let's look at the next graphic, as long as we're chugging along. So we'll come back to this next week, but stars, this is to scale different stars going from M stars, which are also red dwarfs, because you notice they're redder, up to big giant blue stars, supergiant blue stars. Our sun is a G star, and we'll talk about this more next week, but realize this is one of the pieces of the puzzle, and we'll also talk about it, and they are different colors because they are different temperatures. We'll get into that briefly, and we'll get into it a lot more next week. So, next image. This is some real data. This is from Corot, which was a French satellite space telescope that looked for transit events. And here is a small planet, a planet passing in front of a small star. And you get what appears to be a big dip, although realize the scale of relative flux. So normally if it's at 1, you're still at 98.5% of the flux. And that's the easy thing to detect. This is a planet passing in front of a larger star. And here, this is basically what the data looks like. It looks almost like it's hard to even see there's something going on beyond the noise. The noise are all the little wobbles. But indeed, if you zoom in, you blow up this part of the graph, then you see there is a real dip. But now it's, I can't quite read the scale, but it's in the 0.999 something compared to 1. So little teeny tiny dips. This is incredibly hard to do. Then there is a very successful U.S. spacecraft that now is the world record holder for planet finding. Next image is an artist's concept of the Kepler spacecraft, and it was all about transit method and looking at the same 150,000 roughly stars over and over and over. So at one level, it is the most boring mission ever. It just stares the same piece of sky for years. But its results are some of the most exciting ever, because it is from that we have found thousands of planets by finding these little dips in light. Next image is this is a schematic of Kepler. It's a space telescope. It is designed to stare at the same part of the sky over and over and over again and keep itself in position to do that and transmit data back to Earth. That's it. And here is your random space fact certificate random space fact for this week. The Kepler spacecraft repeatedly observed about 150,000 stars in the constellation Cygnus. So it looked at a little patch of sky in one constellation, and it looked at it over and over again for years. But there were 150,000 stars that it could see. And it processed and transmitted data to the ground for processing. And you look, and it looked for at all 150,000-ish, looked for when did their brightness dip. And then they had to sort out what were natural variability of the stars, what were planets. And in order to really believe an observation, to feel really good about the dipping being a planet, you'd like to see it go around three times. So you see it once and you have no idea what its period is. You see it come back around and the star dips again. So for Earth, it would be a year later, the star dips again in brightness. And then to feel really good about it, you want to see it go around again and a dip in the star. I mean, you don't actually see it go around. You just see the dipping in the star's brightness. But that from that, you can extract the period of the planet. And from Kepler's laws, we can come up with an approximate orbit from the period of the planet, and then we've got how much the light dipped, which gives us an approximate diameter of the planet. Let's look at some results and some graphs and good stuff like that, then I'll come back and take a question. So here's one of its early discoveries, which was a Neptune-sized planet in a 0.04 AU. So again, just like the radial velocity, this is going to be more sensitive to planets that are close to the parent star, because when you're close to the parent star for the same size planet, you block out more light if you're close to the star than if you're far from it. There's also another very significant effect that in order for this to work, you have to have this planet from Earth, you have to see the planet go in front of the star. As you get farther from the planet, I'm sorry, farther from the star, that lineup of the plane has to be even more precise. In fact, let me say that again with my fabulous solar system plane demonstrator. So in order for this to work, we have to be looking, of those 150,000 stars, we don't know what the orientations of the solar systems are. We're just looking at a bunch of them so that we have enough statistics that on average, I think it's about one in 210 or something of those systems will have their orbital planes lined up close enough that we can actually see transits. But as you tilt this just slightly from Earth, seen from Earth, then things that are far away are going to drop below passing in front of the star, and things, even when things up close, will still appear to cross in front of the star. So it's really lack sensitivity going farther out in the solar system, and also is only sensitive to things that are very close to, we're looking at edge on. But still, keep that in mind, and we'll see how many planets it's discovered and the implications for how many planets are elsewhere in that 150,000 or in the billions of other stars are pretty profound. Let's look at the next image. So this is discovery rate. We're just going to focus on the top two. Red is radial velocity, green is transit method. You see, we didn't start seeing planets till the mid-90s, and then it's mostly red all the time through the mid to 2006 or so. Then you started getting some transit method with Corot and others, and then you really started to spike up with the green. You're still the radial velocity, you're still getting a similar amount, but now you've got more and more, particularly once Kepler gets in the game. This is from a big data release from Kepler. Let's see, this is last year's. I don't know if you have the updated version. Maybe not. That's okay. 2017, there was another, or 2016 when they were done, there was another spike. It was when they released data on, hey, we found another 1,000 planets. And so this is Kepler almost entirely in that green bar there. And so Kepler has found by far more than any other method using that transit method. By the way, it's really hard to do transit methods from Earth because those tiny dips in brightness are similar to what happens with the atmosphere, and turbulence and stuff in the atmosphere just causing little dips just totally makes it hard to study your data, which is why having space telescopes is so crucial for this method. Whereas having big fancy spectrometers is crucial for radial velocity and actually makes it the better technique at the present for Earth, although there's some transit method done from ground-based as well. Next image, let's look at some statistics. Main point here is to pull out, well, 2 points. First, let's say what it is. We got mass on a logarithmic scale in Jupiter masses, period in days of the orbit of the planet. So, so we got big planets far out or up here, little planets close in or down here. And green is things found by the transit method, mostly Kepler. They are, remember, we have those two reasons that things closer to the star are better for Kepler. One, it takes more years to observe multiple orbits of something farther out in a solar system. And two, the lack of sensitivity to planets if you're not perfectly edge on with the solar system. So for that reason, transits have dominated here, but radial velocity is still dominant out in this realm where you get into the 1,000 days to 10,000 day orbits. Next image. My other point is just, look, it's really diverse. There are all sorts of masses and all sorts of periods, although because you require time to observe multiple orbits, that's why we're not seeing stuff out here. Well, and because these numbers are getting ridiculously huge on a logarithmic scale. Next image is the same kind of plot, but now it's eccentricity versus period. So how circular is the orbit? These are circular orbits at zero and more eccentric, more elliptical, going up on the graph. And again, we see a diversity, although there's clearly a preference down in, there's a lot more that's circular or near circular. We don't see eccentricities in big planets like this in our solar system, at least that we've found so far. We do in comets, but not in planets. Okay, where are we? We are watching a video. I'll take a question before we watch the video. From Nathaniel, what is the closest known planet to be Earth-like in terms of habitability for life? We're still not quite at the point for being able to determine that the other places are habitable, but we're getting closer and closer. So there are about 12 to 15, probably about 15 roughly Earth-sized planets that are in the habitable zone. By the way, the word habitable is fun. I suggest you try saying it. Habitable, habitable. Habitable zone, as I think we've mentioned before, and we'll talk about a lot more today, is where you could keep surface liquid water. And so the more extreme habitable zones we're now realizing may encompass like places like Enceladus and Europa with subsurface oceans. But of the places we're going to have any option of actually detecting any evidence of life from light years away, we are going to focus on the basic habitable zone, of which Earth falls right smack in the middle of in our solar system. We will see this in the two or three of the videos I'll show. They'll talk about the habitable zone where there's liquid water. So the closest, they're still wondering if around the closest star, Proxima Centauri, is a red dwarf, so it is a much cooler star than the Sun. So the habitable zone is much closer in than it is for Earth. And so that raises some questions about habitability. So yes, conceptually you might have the right temperature for liquid water, but you might get close enough in that you end up tidally locked, like we've talked about with other things, like the Moon, with one side always facing the parent star. And so you end up with a super hot side and a super cold side, and can you really do something in the middle? Maybe, maybe not. Red dwarf stars also tend to be high in solar storms, and if you're in closer, is there going to be high solar wind, coronal mass ejections that are going to strip off atmospheres? So maybe the closest star, maybe not. but at least it's intriguing. We'll talk some more about that, and we'll see more in a video. So we're going to look kind of historically going back a whopping 3 years. Every time someone finds something that's kind of a new something, like in this case, it'll be the first Earth-sized planet discovered in the habitable zone by Kepler. They put this video together. We'll look at some similar videos in a little bit. Let's go ahead and watch that.
NASA's Kepler mission has discovered the first Earth-sized planet orbiting in the habitable zone of a star outside our solar system. The newly discovered planet is called Kepler-186f and is about 10% larger than Earth.
Kepler-186f is the first validated Earth-sized planet in the habitable zone of its star. It's the outermost of five planets to orbit a star that is smaller and cooler than the Sun. This planet orbits its star every 130 days, and so this places it in the habitable zone, where it's in a region where it could have liquid water on its surface.
Kepler-186f resides in the Kepler-186 system, about 500 light-years from Earth in the constellation Cygnus.
This planet, Kepler-186f, orbits a star that's cooler and dimmer than the Sun. So while we may have found a planet that's the same size as Earth and receives a similar amount of energy to what Earth receives, it orbits a very different star. So perhaps instead of an Earth twin, we've discovered an Earth cousin.
On the surface of Kepler-186f, the brightness of its star at high noon is only as bright as our Sun appears to us about an hour before sunset. Scientists believe Kepler-186f is likely to be a rocky world, but are unable to confirm its mass and density.
This is one of the big milestones that we've been looking for in our...
So, there you have the start of looking at, you know, what we know from Earth basis is potentially habitable. You get into the habitable zone with liquid water, and you have a rocky-sized body, so it's not some gas giant that it's harder to imagine life, at least on the planet, as opposed to the moons. So let's look at the next, or this image behind me, full screen. This is from a couple years ago, but it's where they took Kepler discoveries and they plotted the stars with the planets superimposed on it. Real point is there's a lot of diversity in stars as well as planets that are showing exoplanets. It's the only real point I want you to get out of that one. And let's watch another video about where now we're finding a bigger cousin to Earth around a G-type star. I believe that's the next video, which is a sun-like star. So let's go ahead and watch that.
NASA's Kepler mission has discovered the first near-Earth-sized planet orbiting in the habitable zone of a star very similar to our Sun. Located about 1,400 light-years from Earth in the constellation of Cygnus, the newly discovered planet resides in the Kepler-452 system. The planet, called Kepler-452b, is about 60% larger than Earth. While its mass and composition are not known, researchers believe that it is likely to be a rocky world. The host star of Kepler-452b is the same G-type as our Sun. It is 6 billion years old, 1.5 billion years older than our Sun, and is 10% larger and 20% brighter. Kepler-452b receives only 10% more energy from its star than the Earth does from the Sun. Since the Kepler mission was launched in 2009, it has identified 4,696 planet candidates, 1,000 of which have been confirmed as planets. Of those confirmed, 12 are near Earth size and in the habitable zone of their star. The mission has provided data that has helped to redefine our understanding of stars and planetary systems in our galaxy. Researchers will use this data to continue to make discoveries for years to come.
So that's just from last year, so you still have similar numbers, a few more, as we'll see. Of these kind of roughly Earth-sized planets in habitable zones. But you're in the 12 to 15 to 18 kind of scale of those objects out of the thousands of objects that we've seen. Okay, let's look at this plot full screen. We're going to look at some multi-planet plots that are from Darren Ragazine. They're a couple of years old. But still, my point is diversity. These are all multi-planet systems. So like our solar system, we've discovered with more than one planet in the solar system. This is radius compared to the radius of Earth. This is period in logarithmic scale, 1 day, 10 day, 100 day. And again, particularly on period, we see a lot of variability. And this is radius of Neptune, radius of Jupiter, radius of Earth. So lots of stuff falling in, including in this very intriguing Earth to Neptune region. Next image. So the next image is a different way of plotting the systems that I find is interesting. And so again, this is just a sampling of the multi-planet systems, of which there are actually 581 known now. And this is a showing distance from a parent star, and then color-coded and size-coded like those graphics were with the earlier, with the red being Jupiter-sized and yellow being Saturn-sized, green being Earth-ish sized. And so again, my real point is these multi-planet systems come in different flavors. They have diversity. They have ones with really huge planets. They have ones with not huge planets. They vary in their distances, etc. And that's the gist of it. Next image, which is just zooming in on some of these kind of things with period and so basically representing distance coming outwards from the parent star, and we see variability, variations, and again, real point, variability. We're seeing it. It's interesting. Okay, now, recently, about a month ago or so, there was a announcement from Spitzer Space Telescope, the Infrared Space Telescope Observatory. They had followed up on observations that were ground-based observations from what's called the TRAPPIST Observatory, Belgian-run in Chile. And TRAPPIST had found a couple planets around the star called TRAPPIST-1. And Spitzer dedicated, well, we'll find out in the video, Spitzer dedicated time to take this infrared telescope and stare and basically do near-infrared transit method, looking at this, and lo and behold, what they found was an amazing system. I'll talk more about it after the video. Let's go ahead and run that.
Imagine a place with not one, not two, but seven Earth-sized planets all orbiting a single star. It's not just science fiction, thanks to a new discovery by NASA's Spitzer Space Telescope. TRAPPIST-1, an ultra-cool dwarf star just under 40 light-years away, plays host to this incredible collection of planets. In 2016, astronomers using the TRAPPIST telescope at the La Silla Observatory in Chile first identified three Earth-sized planets here. The discovery warranted extensive follow-up by Spitzer, whose infrared detectors are particularly sensitive to the cool glow of this tiny star. Spitzer devoted over 21 days of nearly continuous observations to TRAPPIST-1, pausing only to send data back to Earth. It was looking for tiny dips in the star's brightness when the circling planets pass in front of the star or transit. From this extensive data set, astronomers confirmed two of the three previously reported planets and found the third was really three different ones, plus it discovered two more for a total of seven. The transits tell us a lot about these planets, including their size, orbital period, distance from the star, and for some of them, their approximate mass and density. NASA's Hubble Space Telescope followed up by studying the transits to look for the chemical fingerprint of hydrogen gas in the exoplanet atmospheres. While its search continues, none has been found yet, adding support to the idea these are all rocky terrestrial worlds. That makes this a planetary system that is both familiar yet exotic. It is likely most, if not all, of these planets perpetually keep one face pointed toward their star, a phenomenon called tidal locking. This would create large temperature gradients across their surfaces and offer the possibility that liquid water could exist on any of them under the right conditions. Moreover, if you could stand on the surface of one of these worlds and look up at your neighboring planets in the sky, they would at times appear larger than our moon looks to us. That's because TRAPPIST-1 is only a little bigger than Jupiter, and the TRAPPIST-1 planets orbit only a little farther apart than Jupiter's moons. Interplanetary trips here would be measured in days, not months or years like in our solar system. For now, we can only speculate what these exoplanets might be like, as we still know relatively little about them. Upcoming missions like the James Webb Space Telescope will study the TRAPPIST-1 system in greater detail and uncover more clues about the atmospheres and compositions of these seven Earth-sized worlds.
So, wow! Seven Earth-size-ish planets in one solar system, TRAPPIST-1. And a few points about that. They mentioned they could be tidally locked. They may not be. One important note should be obvious, but it's often after the rest of the lecture, but it may not be. Anytime you see what looks like an image of an exoplanet, unless it looks like a speck, it's art, and it may or may not be based on a certain amount of scientific basis. So in that case, they created art where the sizes are based upon real numbers, and then they kind of extrapolated into, well, these three are in the habitable zone, so we'll put some liquid water on it. And so it makes it more interesting, but beware that they are not pictures of other exoplanets. We're not there yet. Other thing to point out is every one of these exoplanets in the TRAPPIST-1 system, including the one farthest out, is within 0.06 AU. Within 6% of the Earth-Sun distance. Again, remember, Mercury at its closest goes into 0.3 AU, so 30% of the Earth-Sun distance. All very close. The reason there three of them are thought to be in the habitable zone is because it's a red dwarf star, M-class star, so it's much cooler, and so liquid water is going to be stable, not out here, but in here, closer to the star. Yeah, interesting, and it's going to take time to extract any additional information from that, but they definitely have people's attention. Let me go ahead and mention at this point, because what's coming up, you've got the NASA test mission, transiting exoplanet something something, maybe that's what the SS stand for. And that is launching currently in 2018, and that will be kind of a Kepler-type mission, but designed to, rather than stare at one part of the sky, to keep looking at some of the closest stars to Earth, and look at those over and over again, and try and discover planets there, and learn about them. And then, of course, James Webb Space Telescope, launching in late 2018, which will be able to start doing things like studying atmospheric spectroscopy of some of these worlds and giving us more information. All right, let's talk about a couple more techniques for finding planets. The first one is astrometry. So remember radial velocity, we had going towards you and away from you, towards you and away from you. Oh, sorry, that's my planet. Stars going towards you and away from you, whatever. My hands are confused. We talked about that. This concept is astrometry. Well, this is actually wobbling like this. Radial velocity just isn't sensitive to when it's going this way or this way. But astrometry is the opposite. It is trying to detect the position of the star changing. On the sky. This would be incredibly difficult, like all these techniques, but there has been little success with this to really, but there at some point there will probably be a space telescope that is capable of doing this. The concept is relatively simple. After we've talked about radial velocity, let's look at this image and discuss it. Astrometry, by the way, is a broader term for just measuring the positions of things in the sky. So here's the star's wobble. It wobbles back and forth in this amount of distance. So if your telescope can detect the difference in when it is there compared to there, then you get, and there's a planet causing this wobble as we discussed, then you can actually extract theoretically, if you could measure this precisely enough, you can learn things about this, the planet that's causing the wobble. Again, inferring it just the way we did with radial velocity, although a different technique, it's all based upon the wobble. Next image is just a different blow-up view of that. Yeah, it's pretty much, it's trying to say the same thing. You're looking at wobble or orbit of, mini orbit of the star and figuring out the angular distance, and from that you can extract information. So it has not had too much success because of the precision required so far. Excuse me. It may be an important technique in the future. Okay, now let's get to the weirdest one. I know, you thought the others were weird. Wait for this. Next image is the technique of using micro lensing. So our buddy Al Einstein in general relativity told us that any mass will bend light, big mass will bend light a lot. And so if you get your observatory and your star that you want to observe, and there's something else, if there's a star in between those two, they line up perfectly because of small, subtle motions in the galaxy, then the image of the star will actually bend around the middle star, and what you end up seeing are a couple identical images of the star. And we see this with galaxies and other things that are distant, where there's some big gravitational object in between, it causes this gravitational lensing. If you have a planet that is hanging out in that system, it will also cause a wee bit of lensing in the process. Again, for a background source, whether it's a star, whatever, very, very distant source, then if there's a planet, it will also cause some gravitational lensing and cause a change. So what you see over time is the brightness of the star as the lensing starts increases. And here, let's look at the next image because I think it's real data and maybe easier to understand. So this is for this very large name star, and it passed in front of a distant object. And so we saw the brightening. This is 28 July. So I mean, this is over a couple months. Brightens, comes back down. If there were no planet, it would just do that. If there is a planet, there's that little micro variation where when it's coming down, splorp, it does some gravitational lensing of the background object and causes a deviation in the light curve, and you can infer there's a planet there. All right, so this technique, there's some good news and there's some bad news, as with most techniques. The good news is this allows us to discover planets around stars that are much farther away than in the other techniques. Still within our galaxy, but they can be thousands of light years away, I think. Bad news, it requires this temporary event where something passes, a foreground star passes in front of something bright in the background, lasts for a couple months. It's not repeatable, at least not likely. These type of lineups don't happen often, and they certainly don't repeat with any regularity. So it's like, yes, there's a star there with a planet. We will never see that again. See the star, but you won't see the planet. So that's microlensing. So those are some techniques. That's exoplanets. Pay attention to this field because it continues to just grow like crazy. And as people come up with more elaborate techniques to both for discovery and studying these objects, this is going to be a hotbed of activity for the next few decades. Good stuff. All right. Speaking of good stuff, let us start delving into stars. And we're going to start with our star, the Sun. So we went out in the solar system, we went out to exoplanets, now we're coming back in to the Sun. But the Sun, both as the Sun as, and as the star that we know the most about and know the best. And we'll do a little bit today, and then we'll come back and do a lot more next week. Let me give you a little some sun facts. So, as I've probably mentioned before, you can fit about a thousand Earths inside Jupiter, about a thousand Jupiters inside the Sun, meaning about a million Earths would fit inside the Sun. A million Earths would fit inside the Sun. We've gone to a different scale now. So we already had mind-bending scales of the Earth and Jupiter. Now we're into stars and the Sun. Another thing, no, the Sun's kind of an average star. We thought it was really Joe average, but now we've discovered more and more of these small red dwarfs like we talked about earlier in the class. And so it's maybe a little bigger and brighter than average, but it's still, you can think of it as kind of an average star. But we love it because, you know, keeps us alive. The sun, we know, is the age of the solar system is about 5 billion years old, 4.5 billion years old. It is thought to have a lifetime expectancy of continuing to burn, using the term loosely, hydrogen doing nuclear fusion, so being hot and bright, for another 5 to probably 7 billion years. So you don't have to worry about the sun going out anytime soon. More precise, the 109 Earths would fit across the sun. So diameter of the Earth, 109 fitting across the sun. It is 333,000 times the mass of Earth. 333,000 times the mass. Density. Here's something you should know if you don't. The density of water, liquid water, normal hanging out liquid water, is 1 gram per cubic centimeter. Well, the sun's light and fluffy and atmospheric out at the top, but it's so squishy in the middle with all the self-gravity, the density is 151 grams per cubic centimeter, so 151 times the density of liquid water. It is burning when I say burning, I mean nuclear fusion, using the term loosely, burning 700 million tons of hydrogen per second. It is converting, and we'll talk about how it does this, 0.7% of that to energy. Straight to energy, that's why the sun's hot. So there's 505 million tons of mass to energy per second. You don't have to know all these numbers, although I'd like you to know that, you know, about a million Earths would fit inside the sun. Nuclear fusion only happening down towards the core, one thing to mention that we will come back to. So, let's go ahead and watch a brief, watch a random space fact video about how big the sun is.
Random space fact!
If the sun were the size of a basketball, then the Earth would be the size of a sesame seed. 25 meters away!
Hey, hold on!
If you like this video,
it's big. It's really big. That's the point. All right, let's look at some diagrams of the sun and start learning about its structure. Let's look at look at that image full screen. So, we see the photosphere, which is named because that's what we see. That's the light. It comes to us from out at the photosphere. But there's all this sun, this huge sun in there. And so let's go down deep. You got the core. This is where nuclear fusion is happening. Yes, that's the same nuclear fusion that's behind thermonuclear weapons, hydrogen bombs. It is happening all the time down in the core where the pressure and temperature are hot enough to cause that. Speaking of which, it's millions of kelvins, around 15 million kelvins at the core. But at the photosphere, it's more like 6,000 kelvins. So it cools off a heck of a lot. Still really, really hot, but cools off a lot. If you are a photon, a particle of light that has been come out of the core, it will take you, on average, 170,000 years for that energy, that photon, to reach the outside. Because things are so dense, it's just bouncing around for hundreds of thousands of years. If you're a neutrino, which we may talk a little bit more about, but neutrinos are freaky subatomic particles that interact with almost nothing. They'll probably just go, most of them just go straight out without interacting with anything, although some would interact some. The different zones, we got the core, got all this stuff, and then we get to the convection zone. This is when, like in the Earth's atmosphere, like you can see in a pot of hot water, as you heat something down here, then it will get less dense, it will rise, it will cool off through photons coming off, and then it will cool back down. And so there's all this convection happening on a regular basis, transferring heat in this outer zone to the surface, and happening on smaller relative scales than what's shown in this graphic. Let's go to the next image. We'll look at a few images that are similar, but just to extract a little bit more information. So similar core, radiative zone. This, I should have said, this is the radiative zone where energy is only transferred by basically photons struggling their way out, and then eventually you get to where you get the convective zone. And as we discussed, photosphere, light coming out, and then you got the corona, which is visible in solar eclipses, and if you have the right coronagraph instrumentation, which is very, very hot but very thin gas. Now I'm going to keep using the word gas accidentally. What I really mean is plasma. All of this, pretty much the whole sun, is pretty much plasma. Plasma is technically a fourth state of matter. It's where it's all charged particles. And so you have the electrons are running free, stripped off. You got protons. Everything has a charge, as opposed to most matter hanging out around us, which does not. And so really all this is plasma. We've got sunspots we'll talk about. We'll talk about this. We'll talk about that. Okay, so let's go on. Next image. I'll remember also we talked last week about solar wind. So charged particles getting pushed out from the sun everywhere. We got sunspots. We'll talk about those in just a couple minutes or next week, depending on time. And radiative zone, convection zone. Okay. Next image. Here's your crude physics for you. So when you get enough self-gravity, you get something massive enough, big enough, squishing everything in the middle, then you fuse. You fuse four protons, four hydrogen atoms, basically ionized hydrogen atoms, get fused into two neutrons and two protons, which is a helium atom. But in the process, you liberate energy. When you fuse those things together, energy has to come out, and it is 0.7% of the mass that you started with is not in this product, but is actually released in energy. There are also neutrinos, other groovy things that happen. But it's that energy that creates hydrogen bomb energy, that creates hoped for controlled nuclear fusion energy of the future on Earth, and that creates the energy going on within the core of the sun. And as you may recall, the little equation E equals mc squared, this is a really crude way to think about it, but C is the speed of light, which is a really big number, and you square it, so you get a really huge number. So if you convert just a little tiny bit of mass, you end up with a huge amount of energy, ginormous amount of energy. And that's what's behind this. Okay. How much time? Yeah, we can start running. Let's run the video about learning a little bit about magnetometry a little bit more. Go ahead and run that when you're ready.
You're probably more familiar with magnetic fields than you realize. If you have a compass and a map, you can use the Earth's magnetic field to help you find your way. You've probably also seen what a magnetic field looks like. Drop iron filings around a bar magnet, and the field shows itself as a series of lines. If you take the filings away, you can still get an idea of what the field looks like by flying a tiny compass around the magnet. The compass points in the direction of the magnetic field, allowing you to draw its shape. But how do you find out what a planet's magnetic field looks like?
Alright, so that'll be the last video we'll run today, but I do want to look at some more images. We'll talk about sunspots. We'll pick up with the videos next week. Let's look at the next image with a sunspot. So sunspots are dark spots on the sun that if you have the proper filters, so you don't burn your eyes out, you can look at even if they're really big, you can see them with your eyes if you have the proper filters. Which is not sunglasses, because you will burn your eyes out, or proper filters on a telescope or binoculars, then you will see these dark areas. Why are they dark? Basically, because they're cooler. They're still thousands of kelvins, but they're not the roughly 6,000 kelvins of the surrounding, so they put off less light, so they look dark. Let's look at the next image. And that was invisible light. This looks like it probably has a little bit of ultraviolet in it. And you got even more sunspots going on. We'll come back to this next week, but if you're ever looking for an answer about why something happens on the sun, it's a good bet. It has to do with magnetic fields. Next image, we'll take a look at a close-up of some sunspots now using specific solar telescopes. And you can see there's a lot of detail. First, there's all this granular nature of the sun that is basically little convection bubbles. Well, they're not little because the sun's huge, but stuff coming up and going down, coming up, cooling off, going down. You've got all this fine structure that is tied to magnetic fields. And you've got probably magnetic fields connecting these two spots here in kind of that pattern that we've seen, dipole pattern. Let's look at the next image, and we'll just dust it real quick, and then one more image, and then I'll be done. Thank you. So this is time, this is number of sunspots. Notice there are peaks, and then sunspots go almost completely away. We're in one of these dips right now. We're just coming out of solar minimum. This is a so-called butterfly plot, because, you know, it looks like pretty butterflies, and this is time. And this is where sunspots occur. They change with latitude over time, and they also then fade out at the minimums. So, why is this happening? Magnetic fields. But what's the deal? There's roughly an 11-year repeating sunspot cycle on the sun. The nutshell, and we can come back to this, is that you've got parts of the sun rotating at different speeds than other parts, and they're all plasma generating magnetic field, and the magnetic field lines get all twisty and wound up and excited and create sunspots, and then they snap and unwind and everything goes back to placid. Okay, we will talk more about the sun, and we will talk about stars next week. Come on back now, you hear? Thank you, and good night.